All praise, all glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the heavens and the earth and that which is between them. May His infinite, endless peace and blessings be upon the leader of creation, the jewel of creation, the master of creation, the beloved to Allah, the nearest to Allah, the dearest to Allah, none other than Sayyiduna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Almighty has blessed each and every one of us with a beautiful and a perfect religion known to us as the religion of Islam. Allah Almighty speaks about Islam in the Quran and He says, Inna Dina indallahi al-Islam. Surely, in the sight of Allah Almighty, the religion is the religion of Islam. In the sight of Allah Almighty, the religion is the religion of Islam. So for this religion, for giving us either birth in this religion or guiding us towards this religion, for that we say Alhamdulillah. For we don't know whether a time will come in our lives where we will wake up one morning and we will denounce the religion of Islam. And that only happens, one of the reasons, or one of the many reasons that will happen and that might happen and could happen, is because we have been ungrateful to Allah Almighty. Why were we ungrateful to Allah Almighty? We did not appreciate the religion of Islam. We did not appreciate La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We did not appreciate the Islamic prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as a result, Allah Almighty has taken from our hearts the religion of Islam. We also know that the religion of Islam started with a few people, a handful of people. The likes of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when it was said to him, I am the prophet of Allah Almighty, there is no God but one God, and that I am the prophet of Allah Almighty, do you accept? Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu did not question the messenger of Allah. He said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I testify that there is no God but one Allah, and that you, one standing before me, is a messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama. The deen was then given to the likes of Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And when the religion was given as a khilafah to Sayyiduna Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Islam then expands. Islam expands and it reaches every corner of the dunya. Everyone hears about this Islamic prophet. Everyone hears about this mission of Islam. Everyone hears that there is a religion that gives rights to women. There is a religion that gives rights to animals. There is a religion that gives rights to the neighbors. There is a religion that gives rights to the poor and the weak people. So we want to know about this religion. Whilst they were learning about our religion, and we had expanded so much around the globe, we also got to know and we learned different traditions and different ways of life. Amongst them, we learned about Hanukkah, the Jewish tradition. We learned about later on, Diwali. We learned about different things, and we learned also about Christmas. This talk of mine might not mean a lot to you. It might not be a passionate speech, but what it is that it is an eye-opener for us. Why? Because we are living in this country and we are ambassadors of the religion of Sayyiduna Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as a result, it is important for us to know what is fact and what is fictional. What is important for us to know and for us to teach our children, and what we should avoid them from knowing and learning and understanding and then adapting in their own lives and for them to pass on to the later generation. A very revered day in a person's life or a Christian's life is the 25th of December. Though 25th of December to us from Indo-Subcontinent, we hold this day in high esteem due to the birth of Muhammad Ali Jinnah rahimahullah ta'ala. This day, the 25th of December, is not the day, the birthday of Sayyiduna Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is not this day, the 25th of December, is not the birthday of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. When you look at the Orthodox Christians and their revelations and what they've revealed and put before ourselves, some will say he was born on the 6th of January. Some will say he was born in between June and July. So there is no sort of proper answer or proper date when Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was born. So why did they put before ourselves the 25th of December? Why is 25th of December revered or is spoken highly of or is celebrated as the birthday of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam? Well, firstly, in the days of the pagans, yani prior to Christ and prior to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, some of the Christian missionaries later on, they found out that there is a day that's celebrated. And that is the day of the 25th of December. And the Christians aligned with the pagans and they said, we will also make this day as our holiday. And we will celebrate this day as the birthday of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Though that did not happen. And we know that there are many things that are brought into the tradition of Isa alayhi salam, the Christian tradition, that are made for people to believe that the 25th of December is the birthday of Isa alayhi salam. You have to have a tree in your house. You have to have a turkey in the morning. You have to have mistletoe. You have to have, you know, certain decorations, etc. That has all come from the pagan way. And the pagan way is what? A pagan is he who follows or believes in a religious view other than the mainstream religions. And what are the mainstream religions? That is Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. So they're following another way other than the way of Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. Now, it's not like the birth of Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani the ulama differ on the birth of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Some say he was born on the 8th of Rabiul Awal. Some say he was born on the 9th of Rabiul Awal. And some say he was born on the 12th of Rabiul Awal. But what happened was the ulama in our tradition, mashallah, beautiful tradition, the ulama gathered and they did ijma that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was actually born on the 12th of Rabiul Awal. So if you celebrate the birth of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, 8th, 9th, 12th, whatever you like in those days, mashallah, tabarakallah, or you celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam today by sending peace and blessings upon him, you have done the mawlid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But that's not the case in Christianity today. That's not the case, because what we're receiving is information which is not real. Likewise, a heartbreaker now for some of our, I don't see many children, many elderly people, or some children, mashallah, about Santa Claus. And this was a heartbreaker to me when I found out as well, when in my younger days, when I realized that actually Santa Claus does not exist. So if I was to say to you Santa Claus, the first thing you're thinking about is a chubby man with a white beard, wearing red clothes and, you know, red and white clothes, and that's what will come in your mind, and most likely holding a Coca-Cola bottle in his hand as well, right? You will think about Santa holding a Coke bottle in his hand. Now, obviously, because he is a name, Santa Claus, we've heard about him, etc., but his name, Saint Nicholas, somebody who gave gifts to children, somebody who, you know, loved children and so on and so forth. As a result, the Coca-Cola company, who are making millions and billions, they, in 1931, brought forth an individual that they call Santa Claus, a chubby individual. You know what we see, and you will see on your TVs in these days, especially because these are the days of Christmas, as I mentioned. So you will see him. But this was a man, Saint Nicholas, was born in 280 AD. 280 AD, yani, subhanAllah, very, very long time ago, not 1931, 280 AD, and where was he born? In modern-day Turkey. If anything, we have more affiliation with Santa Claus than some people who say Santa Claus is ours, because Santa Claus was born in Turkey, although if you call that Europe or whatever you want to call it, mashallah, but we have a sort of a right to that individual, Saint Nicholas. He was a saint as well, So most likely sat in the gatherings of the Sufiya, subhanallah. But the issue of date and today is the commercialization. And people who are taxi drivers or who work in these superstores at Argos and Asda and, you know, Tesco and these sort of stores, they will know that this commercialization has gone to such a level where they are advertising items of Christmas in mid-June and July, because they want people to know and understand, look, you might be spending money elsewhere, but you still have to buy these items that we have put forward before yourself. So we are people who are desensitized, and we are also people who follow the media and everything. And so they've put this idea in our minds, and they're spending millions of pounds on where and how they, you know, advertise these things and the billboards, etc. And this idea is in our minds now that we have to buy a Christmas tree. The idea is in our mind that we have to buy these things to decorate the tree now. We have to buy these things, so we have to save our money for the day of Christmas or the Christmas period, which is now. And the taxi drivers will be able to tell you that work is booming now. Why is it booming? Because people are going towards Tesco and they're going towards Argos and different stores in Hanley and elsewhere and up and down the country, different places, because they know this is a time where people will be going to buy these things. And, you know, it's one of those important days for people in their lives and the Christian sort of tradition. But we know that there are some people, like we have school visits here, and we asked some of the teachers, and they didn't know what 25th of December was and, you know, the reality behind it and so on and so forth. But we do tell them, you know, some people come to the masjid and they think we will convert them to the religion of Islam. But what mostly happens is we actually teach them about their tradition and their religion. And then the reality comes out, and then maybe they do convert to the religion of Islam. And it's a blessing of the city central masjid that we actually explain their religion to them. So, yes, the 25th of December and this date and commercialization, buying these things. And as the children, they know that, look, Christmas is coming up because they have been taught this in school. So we have to buy an iPad. We have to buy a PlayStation 5. We have to buy different toys and different items. But what's happened is, oh people, over time, whilst we have been blessing these children with gifts on end, clothes on end, those same children have become ungrateful. They have become ungrateful. Like if you are treating your children 12, 13 times, 15 times a year, you know, with these expensive gifts, time of Christmas comes, how do you think this child will react when you get him something normal or you don't know what to get him, right? You don't know what to get him. So what happens is people are taking out loans that I have to make this year's Christmas better than last year's Christmas. This year's Christmas, I will go all out. This year's Christmas, I will spend more than somebody who's living on my street. This year's Christmas, I will spend more on my children than the previous years, because previous years we were poor and this year we've taken out a bank loan, so we have to spend more on our children. But what happens after that, oh my brothers? This is why we have a perfect religion like Islam. And this is not for me to put anyone else down. This is not what we're doing. And that's not what I do. And that's not what we advocate here in our masjid. But what I am saying is, on our Eid, we do give our gifts. On our Eid, we do sit together and we have a joyous time. Unless certain people who are having parties themselves don't allow us to have parties. But they're having parties themselves, because one rule for us and another rule for everybody else. But when we are allowed, we do exchange money. Because this is the way of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have not bought things from the pagan tradition into the tradition of Islam. Because this is not what Islam is. Islam is a clear religion. We have a clear book, the Quran, and we have clear books like the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who have taught us what the way of life is. But the issue is, when these people are spending this amount of money, what comes with it, oh my brothers? Imagine this, put yourself in that situation where you're spending that much money on your children that in a year. I'm not saying my child goes without clothes. Alhamdulillah, we are in a good situation and he is fine like that. But what I'm not trying to say is that he will get the best end of gifts and he will, you know, all of these things. We're spoiling our children. As a result, we're having a spoiled society and those children are never satiated. And what happens is anxiety starts to kick in. For those parents, after the 25th of December, after the 2nd, 3rd of January, you will hear these cases going up and you will hear that people are committing suicide. Some people have committed suicide due to the fact that they were not able to pay back their loans. Because their kids are still not happy till today. Their kids weren't happy on that Christmas gift that the parents saved up so much, or they took out a loan to give to their children these gifts that they bought, subhanAllah. So then what happens? They're committing the suicide, they are, you know, depressed, and the blood pressure goes high, and so many other diseases that come with it. A companion comes to the Messenger of Allah. And this is what the religion of Islam, this is the difference. This is why Islam clear. Its days are bright as the moon, and its nights are as bright as the moon, subhanAllah. That's how beautiful the religion of Islam is. So this companion, he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habiballah, how do I spend a good life? If I was to ask you, do you want to spend a good life? Everyone would say, yes, I want to spend a good life. I want to spend an easy life. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? He said, O companion, if you want to spend a good life, then don't compete with anybody else. Don't compete with anyone else. This is why our religion is different to this commercialization that is taking place right now before our eyes. And this has never been spoken of. The reality of this has never been spoken of. And if it's our children in schools, and this is where the fear factor comes into our hearts, oh, our children go to non-Islamic schools. Well, first question is, you as Muslims, how many Muslim schools have you sort of bought in this community and made? Isn't that our duty? Isn't that why we come from Pakistan and India and Bangladesh and Somalia and different countries and different people sitting here? Isn't that the reason why we came here? But what happened is we fell in love with money. We got so tied up in our own lives. We have to think about ourselves, and we have to think about those people that we left behind in our native countries. And as a result, we lost our children. So how were we supposed to pass on this lantern of Islam to the next generation when the next generation is now, subhanAllah, boycotted from the religion of Islam? They are boycotted from the teachings of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Why? Because we don't know, we haven't learned the religion of Islam ourselves, and we don't know the law. So our same children, like my point, they go to schools, and some of these schools, they bring our children into the nativity play. So they are acting out of the birth of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, the wise men and shepherds and all of that, you know, the whole thing. But we don't know. Like if I was to say, if I had non-believers, or we have non-believers, we do in this masjid, like I mentioned, we have school visits, you know, 3-4 school visits a year. If I, as the imam of the masjid, was to say to those children, repeat after me, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. You tell me. We already, Brother Shafiq manages all this, and it, you know, I got a message, Imam Sahib, 60 children are going to come. When I come to the masjid, 30 children are here. So I asked from the teacher, how come other children haven't come? What are the rest of the 30 children? You know what the teacher tells me? And this happens so many times. The reason why those children haven't come to the masjid is because they think you will convert them to the religion of Islam. Not a bad idea, mashallah, but the reality is a fear factor that our children, their parents, are fearful that you will bring them into the religion of Islam. But here, our children who go to these schools, because like I mentioned, we haven't made many Islamic schools, they go to these schools and then they are there acting out. We, as Muslims, or we as parents, we can opt out. Like, you know, it's allowed for us to say, my child shouldn't be sitting in that class. It's fine. It is fine. Right? This is a school. It's not a masjid where you have two teachers. The school, mashallah, you know, is run by the government and it's a good organization. So you can go there and say, look, my child shouldn't be in this gathering because we don't believe in this. That's fairly so. We don't believe in this, all of this acting out and all of that. How would it be if we had, you know, the Battle of Badr or something in the life of the Prophet ﷺ, or the entrance of the Prophet ﷺ in Madinatul Munawwara acted out by children of Christian faith or Jewish faith? They wouldn't like that. You know, Orthodox Christians or Orthodox Jews, they wouldn't like that. So how, as me as an Orthodox Muslim, or you as Orthodox Muslims, how can you allow your children to sit in those gatherings or be part of those gatherings? This is not me inciting hate. This is me trying to tell you that we have rights. There's a law. We have rights, and this is a right for our children, for us as parents to take our children out of those gatherings, right? Take our children out of those gatherings. But it's not also, all very dark and gloomy, the Christmas period. It is a beautiful period. For us as Muslims, it's a beautiful period. Why? For the taxi drivers, definitely. But as Muslims, mashallah, as people of family, we can spend time with our family. We can go to the masjid. We can pray with our children in the masjid. We can hold gatherings, majalis, mashallah, which we will, and we have, and we will, and we have got a gathering coming up soon as well in that period. We can spend time to ourselves. You know, we don't have to go work. You don't have to do this, that, the other. You can spend time with your family. You can come to the masjid. You can hold majalis. You can spend time with your children and so on and so forth. Time for yourself. Time to reflect. Time to know who you are, where you are, and what you need to do as a Muslim, subhanAllah. So that's what it gives us. But I can tell you this commercialization, I mentioned that the Christians are doing it. We as Muslims are doing it. I mentioned that we haven't got no pagan tradition in our Islam, alhamdulillah ta'ala. But what I want to mention is, I was recently in Pakistan, and people don't, you know, I'm nobody to judge. We're not judges. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the judge. But I've seen myself people who don't pray salah. They don't pray salah, you know, five daily prayers. But when that car comes by with a green dome on top of it, like, subhanallah, man, like, what is that? Why are you doing this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam does not need this. They're making money out of this, making people into fools. Like, you have more love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam if you tie the Kaaba on top of your car. Where is this? Who did Abu Bakr do that? Umar do this? Sayyidina Ali did? No, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do this. They believed in the religion that was before their eyes. Pray your prayers. Send salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You don't need to start quoting massive cakes because the Prophet sallallahu will be happy. Subhan, the Prophet sallallahu will be happy for you to come to the masjid to pray your salah. The Prophet والسلام, will be happy with you to give zakat. He will be happy with you to give sadaqah. He will be happy with you to do right by your parents and your children. That's what the Prophet والسلام, will be happy by. He won't be happy by you cutting cakes and putting on, you know, all sorts of lights and going crazy and wild. That's not what the Prophet والسلام, wants from us. And this Muslim now, who has Chulatiga with the commercialization, he's done all of that with the Muslim world, this same guy now who doesn't pray his salah, he doesn't do any of these, he will now go out of his way to buy a turkey for the 25th of December. To buy halal gravy, to buy, you know, all of these decorations. We know Muslims like that. Look, the Sharia does not permit us haram. Like me, I'm an imam, I have a different sort of a stand and a position in the community than yourselves, because in the sense you are lay people, though I am a lay person as well. But if I was to do that, people will see me, and then they will start following. But the problem here is, if you're doing that, your children will also start following in your footsteps. And when they start following in your footsteps, you had your deen from those people who were closer to the generation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So your religion was a bit more authentic than what you're giving to them. Now you're quoting spuds and you're doing all of these things, you know, pulling crackers and everything on Christmas Day. They think this is fine. Then slowly, 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 this so a way of life is then put into the hearts that we have to have a Christmas dinner. We have to do this on the 25th of December. We have to get the tree. We have to put the lights on. We have to put the decorations on. You never did that for the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You never did that at the time of the Mawlid. You never did that for the time of Ramadan. You never did that for 10th of Sha'ban. These things are not taught to us. But what is taught to us, and in a large and mainstream media and everything, is that 25th of December is a day that we should celebrate, and this is what's put into the hearts of our children. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon him on the 10th of Arafah, it was revealed, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam adina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, today I have completed my favor upon you. Today I have completed your religion, and my favor is done upon you, and I've chosen Islam as a religion for you. So when we have said La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, then we need to be part of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah properly, not this faint-hearted business. If you're a Muslim, you're a Muslim, right? You're a Muslim, mashallah. And if you want to be anything else, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us discretion. But we will be answerable to Allah Almighty on the Day of Judgment. Don't spoil these children. Don't put these ideas in their mind. Make them authentic Muslims, because we're going closer to the Day of Judgment. People will advertise this on their WhatsApp statuses that we've put a tree up in our house, that subhanAllah, a liberal Muslim. This is why I spoke about this last week. And I said, we can't be too extreme in faith and we can't be too liberal in faith. If too extreme in faith, you'll burn yourself out. If you're too liberal in faith, you'll become void of religion. Both ways is unlawful. What you have to do is be in the middle way. And the middle way is the way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has taught us. I pray to Allah Almighty that He makes us from those who follow in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and that He makes us people of amal, He makes us people of ikhlas, He makes us true Muslims, that we can pass this Islam, this beautiful religion, to our beautiful children that sit before ourselves and who are in our houses and who live besides us. Wa aqulu qawli hadha astaghfirullahi li wa lakum wa sallallahu ta'ala ala sayyidina Muhammad.